السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وبعد. We're continuing with our Love Notes Q&A from my recent Love Notes Al Maghrib seminar here in Perth. And I thought, inshallah, just to take a couple of questions today and for the betterment of everyone so I can get through them. These are questions that were left behind after the seminar that I wasn't able to finish. There's still a little bit of them, inshallah, and we'll do our best. During the engagement phase, what limits of a mahram and non-mahram would apply in terms of interaction? I just want to be sure that everything is going to be done in accordance to what Allah asks us to do. There's a number of questions like that actually in here, so maybe I'll paraphrase that for all of them, inshallah. Nikah is something that is a very natural process. The aim of a man and woman coming together is that they find each other and that their souls reunite. And we have this belief for us as Muslims that qadr, the fate, is an overarching element in every aspect of our life. And the person that you're destined to be with, whether you're going to be with them until they die or until you both are with each other in Jannah or not, the person you're destined to meet and you attract to in your life was written for you. You've come into their sphere of influence. You've come into their presence. You've been nominated to them. Someone's mentioned something to somebody's cousins, friends, uncles, aunt. You end up working in the same place. Whatever it may be, Allah has brought you two together for a purpose and for a reason. And that's the first thing that you need to consider. So because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the facilitator of that, there's an element of serendipity and qadr that is there. The second thing that you want to do is make sure that it's blessed by Him. Because if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has brought you together, it's brought you together for a reason that you can come together and enjoy each other in that which is halal. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a person of uttermost balance. And some of the things that you see today, happening today, are out of balance. And that's in terms of the hyper-conservatism on one side and the hyper-liberalism on the other side. So we are the ummah of the middle course. So I want to talk about certain principles that you can kind of keep in mind. The first principle is, words from the Prophet ﷺ, never is a man and woman alone except the third is shaitan. Bottom line. There's nothing more that needs to be said. So don't say, I'm going to pick her up, we're just going to drive around, you know, we're going to get to know each other. Don't have that in your mind. Don't put yourself in a place where you're isolated. Now, of course, that doesn't mean I get in an elevator and she's getting an elevator. Oh my God, we're alone. That's not the point. That's not the premise. Alone is meaning, it's not like you're sharing space. Alone in the sense that there is a confinement between the both of you. No one else is present. It's something that you and her are at liberty with each other. The third person who's there unseen to you, in your heart, in her heart, whispering in you, whispering in her, whispering about you in other people's hearts who know that you're together, is the shaitan. And don't think it's about, oh brother, we're not going to do anything haram. It's not about that. It's that you're going to ruin each other's reputation and people are going to have false pretexts. Pretext of how it is that you got to know each other in the first place. You don't want 5 years down the road that someone was saying, oh, you know, they used to get up to stuff. Oh, I know where they used to go and what they used to do. And maybe the only reason she married him is because of, you know, those kind of things are what I see in my position that ruin marriages. And the Prophet ﷺ's words are always true. So that's the first principle. Never isolate yourselves from the eyes, sounds, minds of other people in that sense. The second thing is al-ikhtilat, you know, the free mixing kind of culture that many of us assume as a part of day-to-day life in our Western culture is not something that is conducive for marriages. And that's why 68% of marriages that are built on this kind of free mixing dating kind of culture end up in divorce. 7 out of every 10 nearly end in divorce. So if you think that that's the right way to get to know each other, you're doing it the wrong way because it's proven that it's not going to work. It's proven in that. So what I want to say to you is be reserved. And there's an element of chivalry and there's a nobility of pursuing that person that you want and pursuing them in a way that honors them and that you know, elevates them between themselves and their family. It's a beautiful thing that you knock on the door and you ask permission. SubhanAllah, you know, there used to be a time where, you know, in this Western culture, you couldn't take a girl out on the prom without asking her father's permission. Today, they're taking 2-3 girls out without anyone's permission. You know, it's just that kind of thing. And that's the kind of undercurrent that we see eroding and decaying a lot of the society that we pray will have a lot of reform in it, in that sense. So keep that in mind. Free mixing is not an outcome. It's not a way that's going to give you a blessed marriage. It's not going to be a way for you to learn more about each other, that you just, oh, if we hang out together, then I'll know more about him and I'll know more about her. That doesn't work. It's not the thing that is going to glue your lives together. The third principle that I want to establish is that always err on caution. Always err on protecting your nobility, your honor. Always second guess. Always follow your instinct. Follow your gut. This doesn't feel right. What he said there doesn't add up. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. They talk about applications to work. Everyone, may Allah protect us, adds things in their resume that aren't really, you know, he's a cleaner, but he writes he's the technical supervisor of cleaning solutions at whatever, right? So always have in your mind that there's something more, that I need to read more than just the plain words that are being shared. And, you know, when you look at marriage, the very first phase of marriage, that in engagement phase, it's called the in love stage. Social psychologists, they talk about in love. It's like you're wearing a pair of glasses that they filter everything you see in the perspective of love. So when you see your wife to be, inshallah, and she yawns, you're like, oh my God, she's so cute. She looks like my kitten when she yawns. Yeah, it's a weird, it's like, wow. And then years later, why is she yawning? She's so lazy, right? So I want you to, you know, I'm not saying don't marry someone who yawns, but I want you to see that when you're in that hunting mode, you're hunting a spouse, you're always looking at the good things, and you need to kind of be grounded and slow down things a little bit in that engagement phase. Don't cross the limits. Establish the laws that we know are decent. So don't be alone. Don't just hang out together and presume that there's more to the story than what you're being told. The final thing, I guess, that I would add to this is know that the shaitan wants you to fail. And the shaitan, once you get married, his greatest joy is that you separate. So imagine how much his joy would be to not even have you connect with the person you love. And I want you to know that, yes, you can fall in love before you get married, but that love isn't that fraudulent, lustful love. It's not about the body, and it's not about how he looks or how she smells or any of that kind of stuff. That love is a genuine, pure love, where that person fills your life in a way that if it was to be without them, the world would be darker. It would be dimmer if my wife wasn't in my life. Subhanallah. The sun wouldn't appear with the same brilliance as it does. So that genuine love, where it's care for a person who you can see in their eyes, as the Prophet ﷺ would say to Jabir and to other of the Sahaba, did you look in her eyes? Did you look in his eyes? Did you see that there's something more than what's attractive on the package or the money or whatever it is that has brought you in the spheres of each other? So yes, fall in love in a way that is endearing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, endears you to each other, and restrict your love from the things that will make your love about lust and other things, because that won't last. The final thing, perhaps it could be of some benefit. Now, there's another question that I'll deal with similar to this in nature, so look out for that. But the last thing that I want to say to you is, not because you've made a mistake, it means that your marriage won't have blessing. So if you find yourself in a place now where you do, you know, you connect with this person, but you're going about it the wrong way, and you're not doing the right thing, and you're spending too much time together alone, and you know, you're talking about things that you know you shouldn't, then ask Allah for forgiveness, because that is what's going to build barakah in your life, and ask Allah to give you closure and ease and comfort and make you two together. And the Prophet ﷺ said in the authentic hadith, I don't know anything for anyone who's in love with another person better for them than that they marry each other. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with that love. Allahumma ameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.